Well, George, just let me say congratulations on 25 years celebration earlier this month for PlaneSense. I remember when you folks started and some of the early press events that you had that I was at. And I gotta say, both of us had darker hair in those days. And boy, a lot has happened. Some 440,000 flight hours for PlaneSense since then. It's been quite a run.
That is correct. I mean, it's been a fantastic ride, and there's a lot more to go ahead of us.
Sure, absolutely. So just for those who are watching who maybe aren't as familiar with PlaneSense, I'll give a quick recap and then you can correct me on all the things that I may not get quite right. But PlaneSense is a fractional ownership program that you started back in 1995 with PC-12s. Later added the Nextent 400 XTIs, as I recall. And then most recently, the Pilatus PC-24 jets were added to the fleet as well. And as I said, some 440,000 flight hours and been doing very well. So how'd I do?
That's the frame, yes. I'd like to add, we visited more than 2,500 airstrips. In many countries. We focus in North America, Central America, and the Caribbean. And as you've said, we the basis of our program is the Pilatus PC-12, but we launched a jet program based on the PC-24, but we started it with the Nextent 400 XTI.
Yeah. So I'll bet in 1995, when you started, you didn't think that at some point in the future, we'd be facing a pandemic that required us to change our lives so much, and that somehow that it would work out that it would be almost favorable to companies like yours. We've seen and heard about upticks in the business for charter and fractional programs. What do you see?
Well, we have seen that our business has been robust. I must say that in March and April, we were at 15% year on year, so we're 85% down. So we did have some harrowing moments.
Yes.
When nobody would go anywhere. But as we started seeing movement again, our clients, our existing clients, and then newly acquired clients contributed to an increase of our activity. We're now seeing about 85% year on year. Which is a good place to be.
Right.
There's no question that the concern of touch points and the concern of the unknown leads people to consider private and business aviation more these days.
Yeah. What sorts of things have you done with your airplanes and all the other touch points you have with your customers to make them feel okay about traveling with you?
We always have had a very customer-centric strategy here. So as early as the second week of March, we engaged a specialist, a leader in the field of epidemiology from Johns Hopkins University. And he has been a consultant to my immediate team and myself, giving us data, information, helping us with the protocols that we developed, and keeping us up to date, because I think we would agree that one of the problems of the pandemic was that we knew very little about coronavirus. So from the very beginning, we developed cleaning protocols, distancing protocols, full strategies of what to do if a team member became infected, so that we could contain such infections and keep our team and our clients very safe. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to report that the history of 6+ months now proves out that our procedures have borne fruit. Lately, we also have added coatings on the airplanes that keep bacteria and microbiological cleanliness on the aircraft. And we're constantly looking at new ways to protect the universe that we come in touch with.
Right. Have you had any issues with all of the state-by-state regulations opening up here and there? That must be difficult for you when you go to so many locations about knowing what you can do at any particular location versus another.
That is correct. Our flight operations center is constantly tracking this. It's one, we used to be very concerned about weather and other regulations and TFRs. Now it's what's happening with the pandemic. I mean, clearly we do the other things too. Sure. It's a very fast moving target. In the end, it is our client's responsibility to make sure that they can get in to the place that they're planning to go. We just want to make sure that we can legally fly there. Of course, we advise people in advance about what we know.
Yeah, right, okay. What the new customers that have come on board during this time are, do you notice any differences about them compared to your regular customers? Do they come from a different background? Is this the first time they've used general aviation airplanes?
I think that the larger uptick seen in business and private aviation has been more in the ad hoc charter business. It's the person who wants to do one or two flights, and they now go either on platforms or through charter brokers and charter. We do very little of that. The preponderance of our business is our fractional ownership business. So the people who join us in these days are still either sophisticated business aircraft users or referrals from clients of ours or people who have need for more hours. So the minimum share that we sell entitles people to 50 hours a year. That is not a small amount of hours. So we see a more sophisticated user continuing to be the core of our business. Right. But we have seen more people buying shares so that they can safely move family around and visit elderly parts of the family or the young parts of the family privately.
Right. Have you seen a shift among your customers about the types of trips that, that they make or the places that they go?
Actually, we have. Business meetings are not happening very much these days. So we've seen a shift from the hardcore business centers, you know, New York City, for example, to more of faraway place to faraway place. So people visiting family, the stage lengths of our flights have increased, which is another indicator that the behavior is also different. People are going, say, from the southeast of the United States to the Rockies and vice versa, or from the northeast to the southeast or the Rockies. So we see longer flights happening now.
Right. Right. So before all this started, there was a lot of talk about a pilot shortage and a lot of companies were having trouble finding enough pilots, that sort of thing. What are you experiencing now?
Well, the landscape has changed. We think that we've always provided a very good home for the pilots who elect to make a career at PlaneSense. In fact, as you probably know, we have a very large investment in sort of vertically integrating our business. We do our own hiring, evaluating and hiring. We do our own training, which is developed in-house. So we are very hands-on with the development and the quality of training for our pilots. We also present, we believe, a very good career path for people who choose to be with PlaneSense. So we've always had a reasonably good team here, actually a very good team here. But the sirens of airlines or other places have always been loud. Mm-hmm. And many airlines, in fact, know that we have a very good training program and prefer to hire people from our company. That had caused a significant turnover. And that's not unique to us. I would say that most of business aviation, fractional programs, and others have had to deal with this. Well, in today's environment, that challenge has become much less. We're very pleased to see that in that we can hire more pilots. In fact, we've hired about 40 new pilots in the past months. Mm. And to back up, when we entered into this pandemic-caused crisis, we made a commitment to the team that we will try to stick together. We did not furlough nor lay off any member of our team. Instead, we increased, not immediately, but after June, we increased our hiring and our training of pilots so we can build the correct number of team members that we've always needed.
Well, that's excellent news. Excellent news for your team. What do you think the long-term impact of COVID on fractional programs like yours? And in general, let's say even if we were to get a vaccine in the next year or so, what do you think the future looks like for fractional programs?
You know, it's very hard to make prognoses of this nature. I'd be sitting with you on this Zoom call a year from now saying how wrong I was. So, but sort of a working assumption is that airline travel is going to take a couple of years to come back. Even when there is a vaccine, and I don't want to be pessimistic, it's going to take a long time for it to be distributed and actually implemented. And I think that people will always wonder about whether the person sitting next to them has been vaccinated or not. And until we get multi-billions of vaccines, the problem will still be there. So I anticipate that the business and private aviation will continue to represent a good solution for those who can choose it.
Right. How many airplanes do you have in your fleet now?
Well, we have currently five PC-24s, 35 PC-12s, and three Nextons, but that is growing. We're taking delivery of a PC-12 next week and later this year. We have orders for 12s and 24s for next year.
Oh, so, wow. Yep. Now, you were the first U.S. customer, at least, to use the PC-24 back in, I think, 2018. Tell me how that's been. How did it come into service? What do the customers think? What's the maintenance experience, reliability experience been?
Well, we seem to like to be on the bleeding edge of things. So, and as you know, we've been buying products from Pilatus since 1995.
Right.
A very strong relationship with the manufacturer. In fact, a lot of our feedback has been implemented in the development of that aircraft. So when the 24 started becoming a reality, we were very involved with that. And we were very pleased, as you said, to become the buyers of the first PC-24 in the world. Like every new aircraft, there is a learning curve. And we think that the airplane is fundamentally a good one. Some teething issues that would be to be expected are being resolved. Our clients really like the size of the cabin. It is the largest size in this class, I believe. It is very modern, very comfortable. And its ability to go in and out of shorter runways is also a huge advantage of this aircraft. It also loves to fly, so you can go straight up to flight level 450 to find better routings and more comfortable flights. So we're very bullish with this aircraft, and we expect to be growing this fleet continuously in the future.
Mm-hmm. Is the customer profile for the people that started flying the PC-24s quite different than the PC-12s, or did you have a migration from one to the other, or did the PC-12 customers suddenly realize they had options now to fly to destinations that maybe they didn't before?
I think it's a little of all of the above. Our position was that we had a certain value price point with the PC-12. And we decided that by introducing our jet program, which is going to be the PC-24 in the end, we provide another value price point. So if somebody wants to save an hour and a half going from the Northeast to the Southeast, or going from the Northeast to the Rockies, more than 2 hours of saving, but paying more money for it, we make that available. But for the client who needs to go 45 minutes into a short strip, then the 12 is available. We believe that the marriage of the two types makes the strength of PlaneSense. We give choices and options to our clients. Mm-hmm. We like to call ourselves the intelligent solution, and hopefully we are considered that way.
Mm-hmm. with all the PC24s coming on board, what's the future for the 400 NXI products?
Well, the 400 XTI was a very robust aircraft that we used to enter into the PlaneSense jet age, but they will be retired from the fleet. The intent is to return to a two-fleet program with the PC-12 and the PC-24.
Mm-hmm. So at this 25-year anniversary mark, lots of times the companies will kind of step back a little bit when we get to big anniversaries like that and maybe look at the future and maybe make some business decisions of a shift or launch of something new. What's in the works for PlaneSense?
Well, there's some things that are in the works that I'll tell you later on when we talk again, when they're ready to be announced. I mean, the pillars of PlaneSense are that it is an economically responsible solution, that we target very high level of service, and we use versatile aircraft that are also very cost effective, the PC-12 and the PC-24. We want to continue strengthening on that foundation. We do not expect a revolutionary change. We are investing heavily in improving our training, in improving the delivery of the service to our client. And as we enlarge both fleets, we can also potentially benefit the economics. So there's nothing revolutionary to happen in the next months. It's just more of the same, but with more intensity.
Yeah, excellent. All right. Well, sounds like a solid business strategy, and clearly you've been implementing those all along, having been in business for 25 years and what is a very competitive business. So congratulations once again on that. It's been great talking with you. Thanks for making the time to share with us what you've been working on and how you're dealing with COVID.
Thank you very much.
All right, George. Take care.